Hello, Narnach here. Welcome back to Grim Dawn. So last episode, it was the first episode I recorded with Beta 28. So I did a lightning tour of the Devotion Shrine in Act 1. I found the entrance to the East Marsh, but I require dynamite for that. And I said something to the effect of, well, I'll need to scavenge Act 2 for dynamite now, and then we can return. Turns out that the vendor, the specialty goods vendor in Homestead, actually sells you dynamite. And he used to have 3 sticks of dynamite, but I already bought them. So I've now got 3 sticks of dynamite, which is, I think, enough to go back in. So there's a couple of things. The dynamite, we can use that to unlock the East Marsh. While looking around in the general area, I found a strange key, which gives us entrance to a temple for the Bloodsworn. So that's also back in Act 1, and I also want to go there. And I found another journal for Inquisitor Creed. And last time I did a bit of a rush through Homestead, now it took a little bit more time, and the big man himself is actually here. So after reading his journal, I'm actually going to have a quick chat with him and see what he has to say. So here it goes. It was known that anyone of significance who fomented discontent or posed a real threat to the rule of the Emperor might be visited by the First Blade. I had never stirred such controversy, but I always imagined if such an encounter took place, I could put up a respectable fight. I never got a chance. Taken unawares, I was disarmed before I even knew what was happening. Had he sought my death, I would not have even witnessed the killing stroke fall. However, he seemed more interested in answers instead, and in turn provided me with an account of his own events that confirmed my worst fears. The First Blade revealed that, only days prior, he had been forced to turn his knives on the Emperor himself, by his own command. Despite the myriad safeguards protecting the Emperor, both mundane and arcane, he had become host to an ethereal. Through strength of mind, he had usurped his possessor long enough to summon the First Blade, command his own execution, and charge the assassin with ensuring that his son, the young prince, survived to reclaim the throne. His last commands issued, the Emperor's consciousness slipped once again under the control of the ethereal, and a desperate battle ensued. The First Blade reported that he believed the Emperor and the ethereal within him slain, but given his inexperience with the entities, he could not say anything for certain. He relayed that he had secretly taken the prince and put him into hiding, but declined to elaborate. The First Blade said he intended to retire his imperial title and had chosen the name Ulgrim, which made me curious as to whether it was an intentional reference to the mythic character. A final troubling detail was that no proclamation of the Emperor's passing had been issued. Not only did this demonstrate the ethereals had sufficient control of the palace to conceal the death, but given that they couldn't hope to hide the Emperor's absence for long, it suggested that the next phase of their operation was imminent. I strategized with Ulgrim long into the night, formulating a plan to counter the ethereals, but ultimately we agreed we could not defeat their conspiracy in time. The only course left was gather whatever people and resources we could, go to ground, and weather the coming storm. Then find a way to counter the invaders. We agreed that the Black Legion would be our best hope in securing allies. As a conscripted army of criminals, debtors, and political dissidents bound to service, it seemed unlikely that the ethereals would have any reason to infiltrate them when they could control them indirectly through the military high command. The next step was to discreetly make contact. Okay, so that brings us to where we are right now. Homestead, which seems to be the basis operated by these fine folks of the Black Legion. And up here, we find Inquisitor Creed. So let's say hello. Ooh, that's a nice sword. I like it. So much death and no end in sight. I've got some questions. I've got something to say, make it quick. How did you escape from Warden Krieg's lab? As an Inquisitor, I had access to many occult artifacts and relics that had come into safekeeping of the Luminari. Some that were deemed more benign were occasionally lent out to veteran inquisitors, and I've used them to great advantage. Creek underestimated that. Well, could I have access to some of them? I like my shinies. These aren't toys we just hand out to everybody. They're powerful artifacts that have to be handled carefully. Besides that, they're now irreplaceable as the Vault of the Luminari has fallen into the hands of our enemies. I can only hope that the Ethereals never discern the power of some of the more potent objects within the vaults, or at least wise enough not to use them. In any case, I'm afraid the answer is no. So what does an Inquisitor do? The Inquisitors of the Luminari were responsible for investigating and eliminating any supernatural threats within the Empire. That could mean anything from breaking up an occult coven to securing a dangerous artifact, or even hunting down otherworldly creatures that occasionally cross the veil between realities. The Cult of Ch'thon was one of the greatest challenges because the root of it, the Dying God, is beyond our reach or power to destroy. It has been with us since ancient times. Given their recent rise to power, it also seems to be one of our greatest failures. Okay, so he is not much in a chatty mood, which I suppose is okay. So, Dynamite acquired, talked with the big man himself. Now we go back to where I was. So I was wandering in the Burrwitch outskirts, lastly. And remember from Act 1, that bit with the broken bridge that was over here. This bridge was broken. And there was this flooded passage underneath that we could take, and then eventually we came out across here. And there was a waypoint underground. Well, I figured, okay, so what if I now just fix the bridge, because it only needs a little bit of scrap and a little bit of money, which is a lot in Act 1, but now that I've reached Act 3, I got the money and scrap to spare. So I fixed the bridge and I walked across, and I was curious what's in this path. So it turns out there is a camp with Bloodsworn over here, and, well, the remains are still here. And one of them drops a key that grants access here. So let's investigate. This is a slightly lower level area. Actually, this seems pretty much on the level now. Level 35, level 34. So outside, I think they were level 18 or so, but here it seems they actually scale along pretty darn well. So let's pick up some scrap and some boots. And we continue our investigation. These are Void Fiends. In other games, they would be known as demons. Also, I think my loot filter has been reset due to the patch. I'm now seeing white items rather than only the yellow ones. So, actually, let's have a quick look at it. If it was under. There used to be a drop down. Was there? Did I remove it? Okay, that's very curious. Why is the loot filter gone? That's something I'll have to investigate as to what the reasons were. An interesting change to see some humans again as enemies. As a opposed to all the undead, things like that. Also keep in mind that the Bloodsworn and the Ch'thonics, the Ch'thonians, they're actually a hostile faction. I got a suspicion that the Bloodsworn are just pretty closely allied with them, rather than being their own separate faction. They are referenced as Bloodsworn, but Bloodsworn are not an official faction. Which is interesting. Say in the least. Let's see, there's some food over here. Arcane wand of spell weaving. Let's see how. That's a lot of stuff they're throwing at me. But luckily, through the resistance, regeneration, lifesteal, and raven heals, managing to stay alive pretty darn well. Oh, and of course, totem. So as far as I know, this area doesn't contain a devotion shrine. But it's very likely that there will at least be a named boss of some sort and a whole pile of loot.
That skill's not real.
And loot and experience is, of course, my primary motivation. Some kind of really nasty ritual is going on there. All these cryptic symbols on the floor. Maybe that's where demons come from, summoned by the ritual. Ornate strongbox, that's always good. That's a source of loot. I have to say, for them being two or three levels above me, either my tank is really, really convincingly good, or they are just not that scary. So let's see where the real scary is in this level. I'm convinced that there is a boss here, and that the boss is actually going to be really freaking scary. Salazar's Harbinger! That looks more like it. That's some scary damage. Also, stop putting rituals underneath my feet. I'm not amused by them. So they're killing my hellhound. So let's summon a new one. Harbinger? Ah, there's the actual Salazar, Blade of Ch'thon. This demon looked more impressive, to be honest. On the hand, it's not really about looks, right? This guy does a boatload of damage. And lifesteal. And summons. Circles are some form of lifesteal ritual. They damage me, they heal him. This is gonna be a very long tug of war. this is an enemy that I just can't simply out damage or out tank. Need to strategize a little bit. Because his primary attack is just lifesteal. Come on, get out of the way. Dang it. Okay, just avoid the circle. Again, avoid the circle. Pretty tough bugger. Yeah. Must have been that. So let's pick up a loot. What's up, you? Maybe just take out his pets. Slowly going. He's got infinite energy, basically like me. He doesn't use all of it. But his life is slowly going down. But getting some energy burn on myself, basically, or energy steal, or some way to mitigate energy for enemies like this is probably going to be very useful as a more advanced survival strategy. I mean, if I burn out his energy, he can't cast spells. And if he can't cast spells, it's a lot easier to deal with. Slowly but surely, Salazar is going down. So I wonder when this was added, or if this was there all. Miss. The guy is pretty darn tanky. Or dodgy, that might be a better way to describe him. Okay, take out the Hellion. Yep, there we go for him again. Let's take out all the distractions. That way all the pets can focus on the enemy. Almost, yes, we got him. Hallelujah. Okay. No epic loot. Okay, interesting. So he didn't actually have special loot or anything. Though there is another Ch'thonian harbinger over here.
That skill's not ready.
So maybe Salazar was just the first stage of a fight. More. That one can get a reward yet. Besides the obvious sense of fulfillment from enjoying the fight. Well, there's some stashes in between, of course. Maldwin's cloth, epic casting armor, granted skills poison nova, 24% chance to cast when hit by melee attacks, retaliate with a blast of poisonous fumes. I'd have to give up a lot of armor though. Though for a caster, that's a pretty good item. Well, the good thing is that there is a stash, a shared stash, so I can just share all those things with other characters. And if I start a new one, a caster for example, and I just simply get access to all those items. And now I understand why there was no direct reward for the fight. I got to loot their treasure room. Plague Blood Carver. That's a one-hander. Okay, that's also poison-based, by the way. So if I would play something like a caster that's very much poison-focused, maybe an occultist, Nightblade or something, and some of the items I just found are pretty darn irrelevant for that one. Let's see, what's this? This is lower level, that is also lower level. Found some crafting materials. Never ever have enough crafting materials in this game. Slightly more sorted out. Put it over there. Okay, so that's one dungeon handled. Then let's see. We also have the East Marsh, which I think I can't go to from Burrwitch Village itself. Yes, so there's a bridge over here. So if you take the waypoint here, you just follow the road east. And over there is the detonation site. Oh, taking a slight detour. This is the way to go. So here is a bridge that leads us. It only takes one dynamite, so that's even better. And it takes us to the East Marsh. Okay, so we blew it up and now we need 10 scrap and 8,000 iron bits. Well, I got over 50,000, so that's good. So we repair the bridge and we can move on. Excellent. So, East Marsh, new area. So this is, I think it's a later addition to Act 1, and since you require dynamite to get in, you don't get access to dynamite until Act 2, or Act 3, depending on when you go back. Interesting. So I'm wondering what's up with the monsters here. East Meyer Warrior. They look a bit like the Mistborn. But these are also level 35, level 36. So this is basically, this is just high level content again. And at least it scales along for a higher level character, which is pretty cool. So there are reasons to go back to Act 1 and explore some of these side areas. And it's gated in a way that you won't notice, or you can't access the content until you're actually ready for it. This adds a bit more depth to the world, which is nice. Double test ammo. The specific reason I'm heading into the East Marsh is to get to unlock the 8th devotion shrine that's stored in Act 1. I know it's basically the goal of the entire area. It's all the way in the end from the entrance. Oh, that's a big troll. Well, not big enough. Ooh, and that's a good old-fashioned level up again. So I was gonna put some points into. Oh wait. I only need one more. Yes. So we've boosted the occultist to level 20. Let's see, we get access to the Ember Claw. Brimstone claws tear an arc of flame through enemies within the Hellhound's reach. So the Hellhound gets a attack, which is pretty cool. So let's just resummon all the pets. And then move on, and then just pay a little bit of attention to see what kind of special tricks the Hellhound does. That's those slashes, I suppose. Once in a while you see a slash animation on an enemy. Presumably that's the new skill at work. But that's always good. Seeing my pets do even more damage than before. Robles, death clans, witch doctors in there. That's the thing with Grobbles. I mean, if there's one Grobble, there's about a dozen Grobbles not too far away. Okay. Here, shrine. Where are you? Some kind of chain lightning thing that I saw going on there. Oh yeah, that looks pretty wicked. That's the witch doctor doing its thing. Wonder if it's gonna be friendly fire based. It's like, yeah, whatever, I just need to hurt the enemy and our allies are nearby. They contact, let's use them. It seems like a very goblin slash grobble thing to do. That's not really useful. Troll gate. Rather than a toll gate. Interesting. And that. So this is a very varied area. Lots of different monster types. And skeleton knights. Checking that there's no shaman over here or priest. Corpse dust. This is a pretty nice looking altar actually. And we see Uruburuk's journal, page 1. If you recall, Uruburuk was the guy who basically caused the downfall of old Arcovia. Something powerful is coming from beyond. I have sensed its approach for some time now, but like a dream or some distant memory, the details were lost to me until now. I can feel it clawing its way through the veil, somewhere to the east of Burrwitch, no doubt drawn here by the maelstrom of otherworldly corruption. I dare say its nature eludes even me, but it is neither flesh nor spirit. I must discover what it is we are facing and, should the need arise, seal it away again behind the barrier between worlds. The Order needs not to concern itself with these matters quite yet. I must do this alone. So I wonder if the Order refers to the Order of the Vigil, which are the very people that asked us to take out Uruburuk at the Steps of Torment. More items. Okay. So, some steps leading down here. Another troll gate. Chain lightning on my head. I think I got decent lightning resistance, so yeah, 25% lightning resistance. So yeah, well, they can try. Doesn't hurt too much. Well, let's take out the witch doctors anyway. Makes it easier to hurt the warriors. Also, undead. And here I was expecting an area that wasn't too big. That I could just, you know, explore. And then grab a totem and then be done with it. And it actually appears to be some lore behind it as well. And the area keeps going and going and going. With lots of side areas that I've skipped through. In order to just keep pushing east as far away from the entrance as possible. And onwards to the shrine. And there is a ruined shrine over there. Which was the entire goal of my coming here. Ruined shrine. What do we put in? A chipped claw. So that's something different. Before we needed to put ether crystals in and now it's chipped claws. So which is the one that I care the least about? Just put the defensive ability one in. We get another point. Also there's our boss here. Kali's Ka, the bone hunter. So let's just grab the loot. Forget about it. As if I could ever forget about loot, but just for the sake of argument. This is a pretty tough opponent. A ton of life. Also, a lot of misses and deflects, and she's pretty well specced for defense. On the other hand, their life bar is going down pretty well, while the life bar of my party stays up pretty well as well. I mean, that totem is really, really powerful. Especially combined with the healing raven. And we got another loot explosion and we got the fang of the bone hunter. Let's see. Fang of Kali's Ka, the fallen spawn of Baronath. Sounds like a god or something. Could fetch a fair price at the merchant, or perhaps from a devious witch.
My inventory is full.
And my inventory is full. So that's just drop some of the more common items and pick up this green thingamajig.
I can't carry it.
Okay. So I think I have some area left to explore. But first, devotion. So we were working to complete the goal. 6 health regenerator per second is a pretty sizable bonus, I think. Let's see, where was that stashed again? So many stats. It's interesting to see where they have hidden this. Was the health just here? No. Oh, it's just up top here. I completely overlooked it. So we got 6 points on top. We now got 48 health per second, which I think is quite a sum. Which definitely helps with survivability. Well, I've been going on for long enough. I think I've shown you what I wanted to show. Actually, there's one more thing. If you look at the quest blog, a timely arrival, return to Ulgrim, and the refugees in Deadman's Gulch. So let's do that and then call it an episode. So Ulgrim is the first blade that the Inquisitor also met on his journey. So maybe we will learn a bit more now. So hello there, Ulgrim. So how doomed are we? I've secured the way via Riftgate. Now that we come to it, I can't say I'm eager to experience travel by rift. I hope you know what you're doing. Well, I'll see you all in a homestead. So nice. So they are all gone out. And we have to make our way to a homestead. So this basically connects Act 2 and Act 3 by setting up the last people that need to be in homestead. Actually, in homestead. And this is one of the nice things as well about a single player game. That they can just change the world, as it were, based on the acts you take. Let's see. Captain Summer has something to say about it. So I hear you've dragged Ulgrim's sorry ass out of Deadman's Gulch. Got good work. Come see me later. Perhaps we can put your skill to some use. Take it you don't like him. Let's say that they've got a history. There we go, up here. And now our buddy Ulgrim is here with Inquisitor Creed. So let's say, Ulgrim, I wasn't sure you'd make it out, but you pulled through. Those people owe you their lives. Well, I just did what's right. Got a 500 reputation with the Black Legion. I wish that was the end of our troubles, but there is a mounting threat on the horizon that threatens to wipe us all out. So what do we do now? I'm going to check in with Creed here, but I suggest you speak to Captain Summer. She's the Black Legion officer in charge of this sorry bunch. Look for the grumpy middle-aged hag in Black Legion armor. She will fill you in on this situation. Okay. So let's return downstairs. Hello there, quest giver. I'll skip the pleasantries. Ulgrim tells me you're one tough slith, and right now that's what I need the most. Will you fight for the Black Legion? So let's ask first. What is the Black Legion? Well, you're joking, right? Hey, got hanged. I kind of lost half of my memory there, I think. So, refresh it, please. We are the Imperium's most infamous, if not elite, legion, conscripted from criminals and political outcasts, and tempered in the front lines of the Empire's most brutal wars. The only regiment of the Emperor's legions that has survived the massacre in the capital, if you could consider the losses we've suffered surviving. I'd love to tell you our history, but I really have more important matters to attend to. Such as the mission I need you for. Alright, so what do you need me? We got some reputation with both factions. The Legion is split on two fronts. To the north, we have the Cult of Ch'thon. Nasty bastards keen on turning all of us into a puddle of blood for their rituals. I have my best men out there right now, scouting ahead. The cultists are amassing in great numbers, and I'd like to know why. There is a more pressing issue, however, and this is where you come in. Ulgrim says you are experienced with fighting the Ethereals. That's good. You'll need all your skills for this one. Far to the west, beyond the infested farms and the rotting croplands, there is an area teeming with Ethereals that we have started calling the Gruesome Harvest. It is a fitting title, as the Ethereals have been gathering corpses, animal and human alike, in order to conduct their sick resurrection techniques upon them. The barn there has been giving off a blinding ether light non-stop for the last few days and nights. That is, until today. Whatever they are working on, it must be nearly finished. And knowing the Ethereals, it's something monstrous. We can't risk the Ethereals discovering that we know about their creation. I need someone to sneak in there and destroy this abomination before it has a chance to wreak havoc upon my people. We only get one shot at this, so I want someone who has experience dealing with ethereal horrors to handle this mission. Will you be my champion?
Yeah,
we will do that. Okay. Let's see, another question over here. Weapon Master. The Weapon Master looks out over the supplies and size. It's a damn shame about the cannons. This place would feel a whole lot safer if we had a few of those beauties mounted up on the walls. So, what happened to them? We had no choice but to abandon them on the road when the Ethereals attacked us in force. Thankfully, the bastards don't know a thing about artillery. So, why don't we just recover them? Then I would call you insane. Treading into that area is nothing short of suicide. That's the reason we call it the conflagration now. It's overrun with Ethereals. Even the very ground will cook you alive with ether fire. You like living? Stay out of that place. Just watch me. For some reason, I'm the guy they send in if they have a suicide mission. I'm not quite sure if I should be... honored or not. Let's see. Footman, stay on your guard. The enemies of humanity are all around. Oh, can you open the gate? I'm sorry. Can't let you go through. Okay. So it seems like that way is still not open. I need to find another way through. Maybe end over there. Well, this is really as far as I'm gonna go this episode. It's been long, it's been fun, and I discovered a lot, showed you a lot, and we got all the devotion shrines in Act 1 now. So still have all the devotion shrines in Act 2 to uncover, which I'm probably gonna do in between episodes. Might record it, might not. You'll see next time. So until then, thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you again next time. Bye bye.